Stone is one of the most ancient building materials and is still in use today. One nice feature about stone is that one can stack it. One can put one block upon another, and then another one, and so on. And this way we can reach quite a tall height. But one of the problems that we have with stone is that when we try and span a distance like that, we can put a stone block on there. It's called a lintel, but there's a limit to what can be achieved.
The Greeks used stone lintels to span pillars in their temples, such as the Parthenon. The gaps between the pillars have been successfully spanned by lintels here, since most are still in place even after thousands of years. But there's an inherent limitation to the gap which can be spanned, about 3 meters. In supporting a load, or just its own weight, the top of the lintel experiences forces of compression, which stone can happily deal with, whereas the bottom of the lintel experiences tension forces, which stone is very poor at withstanding. These forces bend the lintel. If the lintel isn't thick enough for the span, it will tend to crack. However, even cracks in stone needn't prove disastrous. Here's a lintel which has cracked. As you can see, if you look closely at the sculpturing and follow the line of the broken central pillar. In fact, this lintel spans the main west door to Chartres, but besides the damage to the artwork, no one's unduly worried. Nevertheless, a technique was developed which allowed widely spaced pillars or walls to be roofed in stone without the need for lintels.
I'm in the Lady Chapel at Ely Cathedral. This is a very spacious building. It has wide expanse of windows covered with stone vault. So how is this possible? The mortar doesn't glue the blocks together, and so we assume that there's no tension. The stone is only in compression, and provided there's enough friction between the stones, then it is possible to create a stable structure, the arch.
And I wrote it down in the exams.
Francis Evans gives lectures on why arches stand, using a variety of physical models.
When I made this, I was playing with it, and one day I lifted one end, and I could actually feel it pushing. And this time I knew it in a completely different sort of way. Not as words that I'd been told, but this time I'd learned it with my hands. And I think that way it gets into your understanding in a very, very different way. Anyway, to give you an idea of just how strong the arch is, I'll bring it down, put it on the floor and show you. So I can stand on it. So it's taking my weight. And yet there's nothing holding it up. You know, there's no glue or cement or chewing gum there. It is just the fact that the blocks are pushing each other.
In an arch, the blocks, called voussoirs by architects, transfer a vertical load on them to the fixed abutments at either end. In doing so, they generate a sideways force. Stone arches are used in the nave at Ely, not in fact to cover the main span, that's a job done by this decorated wooden roof, but rather arches are used in the side aisles. To hear more about the achievements and problems solved by the medieval masons, you can't do better than meet Professor Jacques Hyman, an authority on forces within stone buildings.
Nave at Ely. And Jacques, I hope you're going to tell me more about this cathedral.
Well, I'll try to. It's a French Romanesque cathedral, basically speaking. It was started very soon after the Norman conquest, about 1080, 1090. Took 100 years to build, starting at the east end for this part of the cathedral, working through to the Great West Tower, finishing about 1190. It's in the typical Romanesque style. There are round arches, there are very massive piers, there are really rather small windows in the side aisles. And we have got side aisles because this is a big church. So that in the central space, we have a timber roof overhead, but in the side aisles, where you've got a smaller span, it was possible to vault in stone, and we've got these groin vaults which span from side to side, down in both directions. They are arches thrusting against the outer wall of the cathedral and pushing it aside, as all arches will. And as a consequence, there is one of these hinging cracks running all the way down the centre line of the aisle. So this is one way that an arch can respond to movement of the external environment. The wall moves away, we get a crack at the centre. But there are other modes of deformation possible. For example, up aloft there, adjacent to the Great West Tower, the 20,000 tons of that tower has punched through the rest of the cathedral by 30 centimetres, something like that. And that has dragged with it the adjacent arches, and you can see gross deformations there.
Thank you.